Hello, today we're going to be talking about DNA structure and replication. The learning outcomes of today's lecture are, so after listening to this video, you should be able to describe the experiments that show that DNA is the genetic material and protein is not. You should be able to explain how Watson and Crick deduced the structure of DNA. You should be able to list the components of a DNA nucleotide building blocks. And you will also be able to explain how nucleotides are joined into two chains to form the strands of a DNA molecule. You should be comfortable explaining how DNA replication is semi-conservative and explaining the mechanism of DNA replication. You should be able to list the steps of DNA replication mechanism. You should be able to explain how polymerase chain reaction known as PCR is used to amplify DNA outside the cell in vitro in a test tube. Okay, so let's begin. The molecules of life are amino acids, which are building blocks of proteins, nucleic acids. So today we are gonna focus on nucleic acids, DNA, and RNA, lipids or fats. So those are fatty acids, phospholipids, and cholesterol, and our cell membrane is made of lipids. And we talked about the fact that it's a phospholipid bilayer where you have phospholipids on the outside and the fatty acids on the inside. And finally, carbohydrates. So again, today we will focus on nucleic acids. So let's talk about the history of DNA discovery. So this is a quote from Francis Crick, who together with Watson, they discovered the structure or determined the structure of DNA. So he said, this is from his Nature paper, which was published in 1953, and later they got the Nobel Prize for this discovery. So he says, a genetic material must carry out two jobs, duplicate itself and control the development of the rest of the cell in a specific way. So today we will be talking about the structure of DNA, and this will help us to understand how DNA is able to replicate or copy itself. And later on, we will talk about how DNA can actually code for protein and how that can help control various functions inside the cell. So, history of DNA. So in 1871, Friedrich Meischer, a Swiss physician and biochemist, was working in a ward with patients who were, you know, sneezing, they were sick. And what he decided to do was he collected snot and pus from patients, and he isolated white blood cells from pus. And then he isolated nuclei from pus and finally purified a substance that he referred to as nuclein. This substance was rich in nitrogen and phosphorus. So later on, this substance will be known as nucleic acid. And as we said in the previous slide, nucleic acids are DNA and RNA. So in 1928, Frederick Griffith was an English microbiologist, and he worked with bacteria called streptococcus, and this bacteria normally causes pneumonia in humans. So it turns out there are two strains of this bacteria, a smooth strain, which is enclosed in polysaccharide capsule, in this sugar capsule, and a rough strain, which has no capsule. So the rough strain, which is shown in pink here, is non-virulent, meaning that it does not cause pneumonia. And the smooth bacteria is virulent, meaning that it can cause pneumonia. So Frederick Griffith decided to do an experiment. So this is what he did. He grew R strain and S strain. And when he treated mice with R strain, this is non-virulent strain, the mice remain healthy. When he injected the mice with smooth strain, as expected, the mice died, because type S bacteria kills mice. Then he heated up the smooth strain and gave it to mice, and heat killed type S bacteria, no longer killed mice. So after heating up the virulent strain, it no longer killed mice. And then this is what was the cool part about this experiment. This was the puzzling result. So he mixed the heat-killed smooth strain with the rough non-virulent strain and gave it to mice, and the mouse died, which was quite unexpected, because in the previous experiment you saw that when you heat-killed S strain, the mouse lived. So he kind of expected that the mouse would live. So this was a surprising result. He concluded from this experiment was that there must have been something in the S strain that got transferred to the R strain and made it virulent. So something about the S strain, there was a transforming factor that went into the R strain and made it virulent so that it killed the mice. And in 1944, there was an experiment done by a group of scientists named Avery, MacLeod, and McCarthy. They were American physicians. And again, they did a similar experiment with bacteria that causes pneumonia. So they took S strain and... So this is the S strain, heat-killed, smooth, virulent strain that Frederick Griffith used in his experiment as well. So when you treat this heat-killed S strain with protease, so protease is an enzyme that gets rid of any protein, okay? So they treated it. This heat-killed bacteria with protease, and they also treated this heat-killed bacteria with DNase. So DNase is a type of enzyme that gets rid of DNA. So what happened was that in the protease, when the samples treated with protease, the mouse died, and when the sample was treated with DNase, the mouse lived. So the researchers concluded that when you get rid of protein, DNA remains. So the transforming principle or the transforming factor must have been DNA. Okay. In this case, only protein remained, but the mouse lived. So DNA must have been important, okay? So DNA is the transforming principle. So this wasn't enough proof for some scientists. You know, in science, you always have to show something multiple ways if you wanted to prove that something is true. So another famous experiment which showed that that DNA is really the material that is the material of heredity, that it passes on the information to the cell, which later gets interpreted by the cell. Okay, so this experiment was done by Alfred Hirsch and Martha Chase in 1953. They were American microbiologists, and what they did was they used bacteria called E. coli and a virus called phage. So phage virus normally infects bacteria E. coli. Believe it or not, bacteria can also get infected by viruses. Just like we can get viruses, which, you know, at this time of coronavirus, this is something that we are all concerned about. So E. coli bacteria can also get infected by viruses. So in this experiment, the scientists used a batch of virus, and they also used bacteria, and they also used the blender. So if you want to stop this video right now, go ahead and make yourself a smoothie. Take your blender, make yourself a smoothie. This would be a good time to have a smoothie. Anyway, so what did they do? They wanted to prove that DNA is the genetic material. So they took some bacteria and they infected it with phage virus. And before they did that, they labeled the virus. So first of all, what is phage virus? So here, the phage virus has two components to it. It has the viral capsule, which is made of protein. And inside the capsule, they have the DNA, okay? So the DNA is packaged inside the capsule. And when the virus infects bacteria, it injects the DNA into bacteria. So it binds to the bacteria and injects its DNA into bacteria. So they wanted to distinguish between the viral capsid, which is made of protein, and DNA. So they labeled, they used S35 isotope, which is sulfur, and sulfur is found on protein, because proteins oftentimes will have disulfide bonds, so they have sulfur. Material in them. So they use S35 to label protein, and they use P32, which is a radioactive isotope, to label DNA, because DNA has phosphates in them, and P is phosphates. It's phosphorus, which is, phosphorus binds to oxygen, and then you get phosphate. So basically, what you have to know is that S35 was used to label protein, and P32 was used to label DNA. So they had two experiments going, okay? So here they just labeled the viral capsid with sulfur, and here they labeled viral DNA with phosphorus, with radioactive P32. And then they use these viruses to infect bacteria. Later on, the virus replicated inside bacteria, and they isolated the new virions. Okay? And what they found was, so normally the virus will bind to bacteria, inject its DNA in. So if it was the protein which was the genetic material, they would expect that the bacteria would be labeled with S35, and if it was DNA, which was the radioactive material, they would expect that bacteria would be, in the end, they would isolate bacteria labeled with P32. So they mixed virus with bacteria, they used the blender to separate virus, which was shed, which didn't go inside the bacteria, and bacteria, and they found bacteria was non-radioactive because the viral capsids did not go inside the bacteria. They were not not the genetic material. But in this experiment, what happened was that bacteria was radioactive, meaning that radioactive DNA got injected into bacteria. So that means that this is the material that went in, and then it was used to replicate new virions and gave rise to new little viruses. Okay, so this just confirmed that it was really the DNA that is the genetic material that gets passed on by viruses, by bacteria, to other bacteria, okay? So let's just go on and talk about the structure of nucleic acids, RNA and DNA. We know that genes are made of DNA. DNA codes for RNA codes for amino acids that RNA code gets translated into amino acid code, which becomes amino acids get joined together and they become a protein. So a single block of DNA is called a nucleotide, and each nucleotide is composed of sugar. In the case of DNA, it's called deoxyribose sugar. It's a pentose sugar, a phosphate group, and a nitrogenous base. And there are four types of nitrogenous bases: A, adenine; G, guanine. Adenine and guanine are also known as purines, and we'll come back to that later. Cytosines and thymines, C and T, and those are known as pyrimidines. Okay, so here we have DNA. DNA is a polymer made of repeating units called nucleotides. So here we have a nucleotide right here, and you can see in the middle is a sugar. It's a pentose sugar, meaning that it has five carbons. So on top here we have the oxygen. And if you remember from organic chemistry, which you may have had in your high school when you took chemistry classes. So in chemistry, each corner here is presumed to be a carbon. You could write this down. So here we have the C carbon here. There's another carbon, another one, and another one. Carbon number one is important because a nitrogenous base is attached to it. It's called nitrogenous base because it has nitrogens in it. And there are four types of bases: adenine, guanine, cytosine, and thymine. If you notice, guanine and adenine are double rings. They have two rings here, okay? And that's why they're called purines. So purines are double ring structures, and pyrimidines are single ring structures. So this is carbon number one. So let's talk about carbon number two. Okay. So this is our carbon number two. So why is carbon number two important? Because in DNA, there's an H. Okay, so in DNA, there is an H attached to this carbon. And in RNA, there's an OH. So if we add an O here, there's an OH in RNA. So in DNA, there's an H on carbon number two, and in RNA, there is an OH attached to carbon number two, and this is important. So there's an OH attached to carbon number two, okay? And this is why DNA is called deoxyribonucleic acid, deoxyribose, because oxygen is taken away and RNA is called the ribose. And this is carbon number three. You'll see that it's important because when nucleotides get attached together, so if you ever had Legos or Kinects, you know, if you imagine how nucleotides get attached together, phosphates get attached to OHs, phosphate group on one of the nucleotides attacks the OH on the other nucleotides. And this is how nucleotides get joined together. And we'll come back to this in the next few slides. So let's talk about carbon number four, which is right here. So this is just carbon number four here. And this is carbon number five. So we can actually see it. So there's a carbon here, carbon number one, carbon number two, carbon number three, carbon number four. And carbon number five is important because a phosphate group is attached to it. And each nucleotide has three phosphates attached. And just to make, you know, if we wanted to, we could write them out as three phosphates. But just to make this, you know, less cumbersome, they just put one phosphate group here. Okay, so let's move on to the next slide. So again, here we have carbon number. So this is our pentose phosphate sugar. And in DNA, it's called deoxyribose, and in RNA, it's called ribose. So this is in RNA, okay? And in DNA, it's called deoxyribose. So again, this is our carbon number one, and a base is attached to carbon number one. So sometimes they designate them as prime numbers, okay? But remember that. And this is why it's called deoxyribose, because oxygen is taken away. This is carbon number three. It's important because this is how DNA phosphate sugar backbone is formed, because a phosphate gets attached to the OH on carbon number three. This is carbon number four, and carbon number five is important because it's connected to the phosphate group. Okay, so we can draw our phosphate group, and you can just draw it like this as a kind of like a circle. Okay. And remember, carbon, all life forms on Earth, at least to our knowledge, are carbon-based life forms. And a carbon can form four covalent bonds to other elements. So for this carbon number one, you can see there's two bonds here to the oxygen, to this oxygen and carbon number two, and then it forms one bond to the base. So there's one extra, and it's usually a hydrogen, okay? So now it has four. And this one has four. This one, you can see, has one, two, three, four. This one has two, so you can put two H's here. And in organic chemistry, they sometimes will just say H2 like this, okay? And this one here has two H's attached to it, an OH and a phosphate group. So then you have four bonds. Okay. And this is called pentose sugar because it has five carbons. So I'm just going to say pentose sugar. So for the test, you don't have to actually know, you don't have to be able, you don't, I'm not going to ask you to draw this, but you should know the structure of the nucleotide. So here again, we have the structure of the nucleotide. So a nucleotide is made of a pentose sugar with five carbons, a base. There are four bases and the phosphate group. Again, carbon number one is attached to the base. Carbon number two has the H. It has the OH in RNA. Carbon number three is important for attachments of phosphate to sugar. Carbon number four, don't worry about it. Carbon number five is important because it's attached to a phosphate group. Here we have our bases, ACTG in DNA, and ACGU in RNA. So remember, in RNA, T is substituted for U. So what is the difference between C and U? So if you look here, it's the methyl group. CH3 is called the methyl group, or ME methyl group. Okay, so here we just have the regular hydrogen H, and here we have the CH3. So that's really the only difference between uracil and thymine. So remember, single ring structures are called pyrimidines, or pyr, P-Y-R. And here we have pyrimidines U and C. Those are pyrimidines in RNA. And in DNA, purines, and in RNA, purines are A and G. So these are purines. You can call them P-U-R for short. Okay, P-U-R. Purines, pyrimidines. So you should know those for the test. It makes a good multiple choice question. Which of the following are purines? A, C, G, E, none of the above, or A and G. So it's A and G are purines. Okay, moving on. So how does... Now let's just talk about the DNA structure. And I want to talk about the DNA backbone. So remember, DNA kind of looks like a ladder. So you have the backbone on the outside and the bases interacting on the inside. So remember when you were in high school and your teacher said that DNA looks kind of like a ladder. So here we have the ladder, the backbone on the outside and the bases interacting on the inside. And when DNA gets folded, it forms a double helix. Okay, so the question, so here we have our double helix, the famous double helix. So the question is, how does the backbone come together? So what happens is that the phosphate on one nucleotide attacks the OH on the other nucleotide. So the phosphates get attached to the sugars. So when your teacher in high school said that DNA has sugar phosphate backbone, this is exactly what she meant. So when phosphate gets attached to the OH, this is done by a reaction called the condensation reaction, where the H here, there's the H here, and the OH, they form a structure called H2O, which is known as water, and water goes away, and the O gets attached here, so you get phosphate. This phosphodiester bond is formed. So this is the phosphodiester bond, and the water goes away. Okay. So here is just a summary again. Phosphate attached to 5' carbon attacks the OH on the 3' carbon. Okay. Excellent. So let's move on. So an enzyme, so to do this chemical reaction or biochemical reaction, you need an enzyme called DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase is an important enzyme that synthesizes DNA. So it's important in DNA synthesis. This enzyme replicates DNA or helps to make copies of DNA molecules. Okay, so here we have a DNA strand, and you see a nucleotide coming in, a new nucleotide, and this phosphate on 5' carbon is going to attack the 3' carbon. So DNA synthesis has a direction to it. It's always done in 5' to 3' direction. So it's 5' to 3'. So, you know, as an undergraduate student, I used to be confused. So what does this really mean, 5' to 3' direction? What it means is the 5' carbon attacks the 3' carbon. So the phosphate group on the 5' carbon attacks the OH on the 3' carbon. So this is a good way to remember that DNA synthesis is always in 5' to 3' direction. Okay, and here we have a DNA nucleotide chain, and you can see that you have the sugars, which are known as deoxyribose sugar, sugar phosphate backbone, and you have the bases on the inside here. And this is an RNA chain. This is RNA polymer here made of RNA nucleotides. And you have the ribose sugar with OH. Okay, so here's our OH. And you have nucleotides and, sorry, bases, RNA bases, and one of them is uracil, because in DNA you have T's and in RNA you have U's. So this is just a summary again, differences between DNA and RNA. They both have a pentose sugar, but in DNA you have deoxyribose, in RNA you have ribose, okay? And in DNA you have T's and RNA you have U's for bases. They both have phosphate groups. DNA is double-stranded, so you'll say DS for double-stranded, and RNA is single-stranded. So DNA has a structure. It's a double helix, and RNA, it's very stable. So DNA is very stable. It has a structure called DNA double helix. RNA is not very stable, and it's a single strand. And it forms loops, you know, loops. So it's unstable at room temperatures. It's also quickly degraded at 4 degrees. So it's hard to work with RNA in the lab. RNA first has to be converted to DNA if you wanted to sequence or find out the code of RNA. So as a rule, if you are working in a lab and you have a molecule of RNA and you want to identify it in some way, you first want to convert it to DNA, because DNA is stable and you can actually work with DNA. DNA is stable at room temperature. DNA, this is why they're able to do some like archaeology where they excavate, more like genetic paleontology, archaeology, where they excavate bones of kings and queens, and then they're able to isolate the DNA from those bones, and then they can actually find out if a certain king had a particular genetic disease, or they can even isolate like microorganisms from remnants of, you know, people like kings, queens, just regular people who have been, you know, buried, and then they can find out what type of bacteria they had in their gut, and even because they can isolate DNA from those microorganisms and identify them. Okay, anyway, so here we have, the two strands of DNA, and what we have to remember that DNA strands have a direction to them. So in molecular biology, the convention is to draw DNA strands like this, where the top strand is 5 prime to 3 prime. Okay. And again, all that means is that there's a 5 prime carbon on this end with a phosphate. So there's a phosphate hanging off of this end and an OH on this end. If you wanted to, you could draw a phosphate group here on this end, and there's going to be an OH on this end. So this is the top strand, known as the top strand, also known as the 5 prime to 3 prime strand. And this is also known as the sense strand. And this is the antisense strand, or 3 prime to 5 prime strand, okay? Or the bottom strand, known as antisense strand. Okay, So we said that the bases are interacting in the middle, in inside. So you see that A always goes with T, and T goes, so this is known as a base pairing rule. So T goes with A goes with T, and C goes with G, and G's goes with C's. And A's and T's form two hydrogen bonds to each other, and C's and G's form three hydrogen bonds to each other. Okay, and what are hydrogen bonds? So hydrogen bond is a bond between hydrogen and oxygen, hydrogen and fluoride, or hydrogen and nitrogen. And what's cool about hydrogen bonds is they can be easily separated. Okay, so this allows for DNA molecule, the two strands of the DNA molecule to actually separate so that each strand can be copied into a new strand. So if the bases were attached by covalent bonds, which are very strong and cannot be really easily separated, this means DNA, the two strands of DNA would be stuck together and you couldn't copy them. And remember what Crick said in his quote, he said that DNA molecule has to be copied or replicated. And basically, hydrogen bonds can be unzipped or undone, and they're also strong, so they can hold the two strands together, but they can also be undone so that each strand can be copied. So this is why it's really cool that there are hydrogen bonds here. And DNA polymerase, once again, it's an enzyme that adds the new nucleotide. And when a new nucleotide comes in, so suppose there's a G here, the new nucleotide has to be C, okay? So if you have a strand like ACTG and you want to copy this strand, when a new nucleotide comes in and it's going to be opposite of A, it has to be T. If a new nucleotide is going to be opposite of C, it has to be G. Because we are following base pairing rule, also known as Chargaff's rule, after Edwin Chargaff, who made the discovery that A's and T's are always present in equal proportion in the cell, and C's and G's are always present in equal proportion in the cell. So I just wanted to go back for a second to the history of DNA again and how they really realized that DNA has this particular structure to it. So let's go back here. Watson and Crick, they did not perform any experiments, but they used molecular modeling. And this is them with their DNA model to understand the structure of DNA. They used cardboard cutouts, and they used later made this structure using metal. So how did they deduce the structure of the DNA? They needed experimental evidence to do that. So first, they had evidence from Phoebus Levine, who was a Russian-Jewish-American biochemist. He identified that DNA and RNA have five carbon sugars known as ribose and deoxyribose, and he made this discovery in 1929. So this is Watson and Crick knew this when they were working on the structure of DNA, and they also knew that DNA nucleotides have a sugar, phosphate, and a base. They also came across a paper by Erwin Chargaff, who was a biochemist. And he, the experiment that he did, he took bacteria, you know, plants, plant cells, and cells from different organisms, and he was measuring the amounts of adenine, guanine, thymine, and cytosine. And what he found that adenine and thymine were always in the same ratio, and so adenines will in 1-to-1 ratio to thymine, and guanines will in 1-to-1 ratio to cytosines. And what this, when Watson and Crick came across Chargaff's paper, they realized that adenine must pair up with thymine, and guanine must pair up with cytosine. Okay, and this was really a major thing for them, because they at first they did not know how the bases are stacked together when it comes to DNA. Nobody knew that. It was really their original idea, and they realized that once they, you know, when they looked at Chargaff's paper. Rosalind Franklin was really instrumental in the discovery of DNA structure. She actually took an X-ray image of DNA using a technique called X-ray crystallography. And she essentially photographed DNA. And it turns out that DNA occurs in two forms, A form and B form. It took Franklin 100 hours to obtain the famous photo 51 of the B form of DNA. And as you know, unfortunately, there was a lot of misunderstanding going on. Her colleague, Maurice Wilkins, who was working with her, he took this picture and gave it to Watson Crick without her knowledge, without her specific permission. In fact, she was working on an article on a science paper at the time. She was going to essentially publish a paper about the structure of DNA. But you looked at her image and they sort of beat her to it. There's also Z form of DNA. Watson and Crick were lucky that they got photo 51 because it had the B form, which was easier to understand. Okay, so Rosalind Franklin was British biochemist. She also worked on the structure of hemoglobin and tomato bushi virus, which is a virus that commonly infects tomatoes. She was a daughter of a banker. She came from a wealthy Jewish family. Her father actually helped hide, and he took in a few refugees from Germany. Rosalind Franklin never married, and she trained as an X-ray crystallographer in France. There's a movie about Rosalind Franklin with a famous actor, Nicole Kidman. You might not know her, she's at this point an older actress, but she plays Rosalind Franklin. Alright, so Rosalind Franklin tragically passed away from ovarian cancer. Anyway, this is a picture of Rosalind Franklin with her photo 51, and again, a brilliant scientist. Sadly, she did not get Nobel Prize because Nobel Prize is not given posthumously, and she already passed away by the time they gave Watson and Crick their Nobel Prizes. Maurice Wilkins was awarded a Nobel Prize together with Watson and Crick. Okay, so this is just a summary of DNA structure discoveries. Edwin Meischer finds out nuclein in blood cell nuclei of isolated from pus and snot of patients. Frederick Griffith finds out that there is a transforming principle present in bacteria. Avery's group does an experiment where they find that DNA transmits the transforming principle. DNA is the transforming principle. Martha and Hershey Chase experiment with a blender confirms that a part of the virus which infects bacteria, part of the virus which gets replicated in bacteria and gives rise to new variants is nucleic acid. Is DNA, not protein. Watson and Crick elucidate the three-dimensional structure of DNA based on the work of Phoebus Levine, Erwin Chargaff, Morris Wilkins, and Rosalind Franklin. So we said previously that DNA has a sugar phosphate backbone and the nucleotides are stacked in the middle. DNA is antiparallel. It has a direction. One strand is 5-2-3 and the other one is 3-2-5. So we say DNA is antiparallel. DNA has a direction to it. One strand is 5-2-3, it's called the sense strand, and the other strand is 3-2-5, it's the anti-sense strand. Complementary base pairing. A goes with T, and T goes with A. G goes with C, and C with G. Right here in this slide, you can see there is a mistake. It should say that complementary base pairs are A goes with T and C goes with G, okay? Hydrogen bonds hold the base pairs together. Interestingly, this was a slide from the textbook's author, so, okay. Anyway, so here we have A's and T's form two hydrogen bonds and C's and G's form three hydrogen bonds. So give yourself a break before you go to the next section, which is DNA replication. So the question is, how does DNA get copied? So how do you go from two strands? So suppose you have a daughter cell and it has, you know, obviously it has chromosomes in it, and each chromosome has to get replicated. So suppose you have your DNA molecule. How? So the daughter cell divides, and before it divides, DNA has to be doubled because you're going to have two cells, and each cell, each daughter cell, has to get a copy of the DNA. Okay? So the question is, how do you copy DNA? So one way would be to just make it from scratch. You just take a DNA molecule and you make two new ones. Now, this would be a waste of energy. So if you're, you know, when you were younger, you probably watched Bob the Builder. Reuse, reduce, recycle, right? So you want to recycle what you have. So it turns out that DNA replication follows this principle. DNA replication is semi-conservative. So what happens is the two DNA strands get separated, and then each strand serves as a parental strand, and it serves as a template for the new strand. So here in purple, we have the two parental strands. They unzip because the hydrogen bonds can be disrupted. And now the new strands are synthesized, shown in pink. So here we have the parental strand set GGGT. So the new strand would be using the base pairing or Chargaff's rule. It's CCCA, okay? So if you wanted to write it down like this, so suppose the 5 prime to 3 prime strand is GGGT. Okay, so we have to put the direction 5 prime to 3. So what is, so here's a question for you. What is the directionality of the new strand? So it has to be antiparallel, so it has to be 3-2-5. And what is the code? What is the matching code? Use Chargaff's rule. GC 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 A. Excellent. Okay. So moving on. How does DNA replication actually occur? So basically, it's a process that, you know, takes about 1 hour in the cell, but it depends on the type of cell. DNA replication might occur faster or slower in different cell types. And replication takes place in many places along the chromosome. And when replication starts, it forms a replication bubble, okay? some very nice associations with bubbles. If you have bubbles, you could take now your bubble solution, you could, you know, make some bubbles to make it fun, okay? And as they say on YouTube, satisfying. So yeah, so maybe you can take some slime and you can squish it and then you get a bubble. So that's nice. Okay, anyway, so here we have the replication bubble, and we can let's look at the mechanism of this. So it turns out that the two DNA strands unzip and separate, and remember, DNA always gets replicated from 5 prime to 3 prime direction. This is how DNA polymerase works. It works 5 to 3 prime because 5 prime phosphate attacks 3 prime OH. So here we have this replication taking place, and the new strand, which is uses 3 to 5 prime strand as a template, is called the leading strand. As the strands separate, a DNA fork forms. This is called DNA or replication fork. Okay, and there's a lot of space here for the enzyme to come in and do its job. So the leading strand is formed continuously. The leading strand is formed continuously. Okay. Continuously. And the other strand is called the lagging strand, and the lagging strand is formed discontinuously, and it's made of Okazaki fragments, named after a team of husband and wife scientists from Japan. And the reason why it's formed as Okazaki fragments, because DNA polymerase does not work in this free. It can't go this way from 3 to 5 prime. It has to go this way from 5 to 3 prime. There's not enough space here. And, you know, the truth is we don't quite understand why Okazaki fragments are formed discontinuously. But the enzyme has to work from 5 to 3 prime and goes this way. Okay. So there are three steps to the formation of the Okazaki fragments. First, a primer has to be added. So there's an enzyme called, primase, okay? So first helicase, an enzyme called helicase separates the two strands, and a replication fork is formed. Binding proteins attach, so you can ignore that. DNA replication does not happen right away. It needs a short piece of RNA fragment called a primer so it can start replication. Just like when you paint a room in a house, you need a primer, right? You're not just going to put paint on the walls. So here, to start DNA replication, so here's your old strand, here's your template strand, you need something called a primer. So the primer is a short piece of RNA which is going to match up to the beginning few nucleotides here at the 5 prime end. Okay. And then DNA replication can continue and you can make the DNA strand. Okay. So a primase adds a short primer to the template strand, and then DNA polymerase takes over and it adds nucleotides to form the new DNA strand. And then ligase comes in and joins Okazaki fragments together. It repairs, it seals the sugar phosphate backbone. So let's look at this in action. Here we have the leading strand being formed, it's continuous. And here you have helicase enzyme comes in, it unzips the DNA, it forms the DNA replication fork. Primase makes short stretches of RNA as primers So this is our primers. And if you understand this process, it's going to be easier for you to understand polymerase chain reaction method. Okay, so we have primers, PCR, which is polymerase replication, polymerase chain reaction, sorry. PCR uses primers as well. So here we have primers made by primase enzyme. And now we have DNA polymerase, which comes in and makes the DNA strand. And continuously here and discontinuously here makes Okazaki fragments. Remember, the strands are always made in 5-3 prime direction. Continuous strand, and here's our discontinuous synthesis of Okazaki fragments. Okay, and it's also 5'-3' direction. Okay, and finally, enzyme removes RNA primers. DNA polymerase fills in those missing nucleotides, and then ligase seals sugar phosphate backbone. Okay, and these are our DNA replication bubbles, and now the new strands are formed and the chromosome has been replicated. So if on the test you see a question and it says which enzymes are involved in DNA replication, this would be helicase, primase, DNA polymerase, and ligase. Okay, and if ever on the test it says what is the direction of DNA replication, it's always in 5-3' direction. Okay, excellent. So we are done with DNA replication. And now we can go on to polymerase chain reaction known as PCR. So what is so cool about PCR? PCR amplifies DNA. So if you have a small amount of DNA, like you just excavated bones of some ancient human and you wanted to amplify the amount of DNA found, you know, that you isolated from those old bones, you would use PCR, polymerase chain reaction, the most famous method in molecular biology, arguably. Okay, so you can amplify your DNA strand up to 10 billion. You can make 10 billion copies from one strand of DNA. So this is a lot. This is really cool. It can also be used in forensics. So suppose you have a strand of hair that has a hair follicle on it. You could isolate DNA from the hair follicle and you could amplify it using PCR. In fact, nowadays they have another technique where they don't even need a hair follicle. They can just use a person's hair and they are able to isolate a small amount of DNA like stuck to the hair, like pieces of DNA, and then they can amplify it using PCR. Okay, so if you understood DNA replication, you should be able to understand PCR. So what do we need for PCR? We need a template right here. Let's do something fun here. Highlighter. This is our template right here. Okay. This is our target sequence. This is something that you want to amplify. So suppose you have a person here who is sick with COVID-19. This poor guy has COVID-19. So you go, you use a swab and you go inside his nose and you isolate some sample, snot sample. And you purify DNA, which is your target sequence right here. So another thing that you need to know what gene you want to amplify. So suppose you want to amplify S1 gene. Okay, so this is S1 gene from Coronavirus, our favorite corona. Actually, we hate it. We really do. Okay, so this is S1 gene. So we need to know something about S1 gene before we can amplify it. We should know something about S1 gene. We should, ideally, you should know its sequence, ACTG code, and you should know the flanking sequences of S1. So if this is your S1 right here, so you should know its flanking sequences. So something that is just on each end right here. So you can design a primer. Okay, so this is the 5' end, and you have this flanking sequence of the 5' end and the flanking sequence of the 3' end, okay? So what you want to do is design a primer that matches to this end right here, matches to whatever is the sequence right here, okay? And you want to design a primer that, so, yeah, I know, DNA is double-stranded, so you want to, this is our gene, obviously it has two strands. Okay, so here's our gene, this flanking sequences. So you want to design a primer that matches the sequence right here on the 3' end, okay? So you want, so for this PCR reaction, you need two types of primers. 5' primer and 3' primer. Okay. Primers. So you can design those primers by there's software online, like apps. There's an app for everything, right? There's even an app for designing primers. So you go to this app, you plug in the sequence for your S1 gene from your favorite NCBI database that we are going to be using in this course. So you plug in your S1 sequence and it will tell you what the ideal primers would be for your reaction. Okay, you can get nucleotides. Those nucleotides would be A, C, T, and drumroll, G. Yay. Okay, and where would you get those nucleotides? You can buy them from companies, and they're sold in test tubes. Okay, and you would add them in equal concentration. You also need TAC resistant, an enzyme called TAC, T, A, and Q. This is heat resistant DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase. It's an enzyme that synthesizes DNA, makes new strands of DNA. Why is it called TAC? Because it's isolated from a bacteria that lives in a very hot water, in usually in nuclear plants. Okay, nuclear plants, they have water reservoirs, and this very interesting bacteria lives in that those hot springs, hot at nuclear stations. Okay, so this is another good thing about nuclear stations, you can get TAC DNA polymerase from them. Okay, anyway, so how is PCR done? So you have your target sequence in the first, so you also need a PCR machine known as a thermocycler. PCR known as thermocycler, and it's not expensive to buy them. You could probably buy them yourself if you wanted to, for like $100. Okay, and so you have PCR thermocycler, and it depends what kind. You can buy a tabletop one, you could buy a small one, you could buy one from Josiah Zahner. I'm not advertising him, he's a biohacker. He has his website, Odin, and he's selling one on that website. You could buy one from Kickstarter. There's a cute one, which is like the size of a stapler. Okay, So we have PCR thermocycler, and PCR reaction has to go through cycles. So in the first cycle, parental strands get unzipped. So this is the first part. So in the first, so this is a cycle, and the cycle goes through temperatures. Okay, so first DNA is heated to 96 degrees Celsius, and your sample is heated and DNA unzips. Then it goes to 72 degrees Celsius, and primers anneal or hybridize to the template. So this is annealing, anneal, primers anneal. So if you have a friend named Neil, this is a good way to remember it. But I think Neil is a relatively rare name right now, so you probably don't know anyone named Neil. Maybe an uncle. Okay. So primers anneal to the template, and then DNA fills in, and basically the new strand is formed, and this process is repeated several times. And then DNA goes to 50 degrees Celsius here when DNA fills in. And then the cycle repeats. Okay. So this is the coronavirus, and let's talk about coronavirus. So coronavirus replication. So here we have spike proteins, which we heard so much about lately. Spike protein attaches to the ACE2 receptor on the human cell. Positive strand of RNA is released. And coronavirus has a single positive stranded RNA genome, which is used to directly produce polyproteins. Polyproteins are going to be used to assemble the virus again. So the virus doesn't lose any time this way. It can just use the host ribosome machinery to make those polyproteins. RNA genome is replicated using viral RNA polymerase, and RNA polymerase replicates the RNA, and then that RNA can be packaged into the new variants and exported out of the cell. Talk about DNA sequencing today. Okay. We'll continue on during class, and I'll talk about DNA sequencing. Coronavirus is an A.